In this video, we'll go over some key ideas for creating an exercise program that not only fits your needs and ability, but also progresses you along efficiently and with the most beneficial results possible. So how does good programming accomplish this? Well, as we discussed earlier, the human body can change based on external influences from the environment that it finds itself in. Muscles will grow as a response to lifting heavy things on a regular basis, just as lung capacity and VO2 max scores will also increase as a response to performing intense aerobic and anaerobic activities on a regular basis. However, the human body will only continue to get better at lifting objects or running further by building muscle or increasing the lungs capacity to a certain point. If you lift the same object in the same way over and over again, your muscles will eventually stop growing and stop getting stronger. This diminishing return results because at this point, for your muscles to grow or get stronger, the amount of energy required would be overkill and deemed wasteful for the task that they're adapting to in the first place. The same goes for aerobic and anaerobic fitness. Once your body reaches a certain level of adaptation to the demand, it will no longer continue to get better, as this would be over and above what it decides is currently needed. You may have heard of people plateauing in exercise before. Now, this diminished return from a familiar routine is what constitutes a performance plateau. A good program will get you around this problem. At its core, a good program contains movements and exercises necessary to promote optimal health and fitness for the individual, while having the foresight to know that those movements and workouts will have diminishing results the longer a person continues to perform them. Continued adaptations in strength, endurance, and body composition can be ensured throughout a comprehensive program by changing specific variables over time and thereby forcing the body to readapt before a plateau can occur. Now, there are many variables which a program can manipulate and any number of combinations thereof. Anytime you slow down or speed up your repetitions, increase or decrease the resistance of an exercise, change the amount of rest time between sets, you're manipulating the variables of your program. Knowing how and why you change these variables and basing those decisions on your current level of fitness will dictate when you introduce them into the timeline of your program. All of these variables will have different effects on the measures of your fitness, of which there are two main types: health-related fitness and skill-related fitness. If you neglect any one part of either of these departments, your program will be unbalanced and lead to weaknesses in your overall fitness level down the road. Now, both health-related fitness and skill-related fitness can be broken down further into smaller components, which can be measured and tested. When you measure and test these components of fitness over weeks and months, you begin to paint a picture of where your strengths and your weaknesses lay. In so doing, you can create small changes to future workouts to bring all of those into a closer balance. Measuring strength, cardiovascular ability, and body composition gives you an idea of your fitness level as it relates to your overall health. Let's start with strength. To measure strength, you don't just see how much you can lift in one maximum effort. Strength is a combination of a person's ability to exert maximal effort balanced with the capacity to move a smaller amount of weight for more repetitions over an extended duration of time and through full ranges of motion. Your program should eventually bring these three types of strength, maximal strength, strength endurance, and strength through full ranges of motion, into balance with one another. Now, if the word strength scares you and you're worried about getting too big and bulky, just remember that 1 pound of fat is about the size of two of my fists, while 1 pound of muscle is the size of one of my fists. Also, the more muscle you have on your frame, the faster your metabolism, and that just leads to more rapid loss of fat. I assure you, building strength and muscle is relevant to just about anybody's goals. Okay, so let's now talk about cardiovascular fitness. Cardiovascular fitness is your body's ability to supply working muscles with sufficient oxygen and energy, and the ability of those muscles to metabolize energy for doing the necessary work. When you run on a treadmill for any length of time or play regular sports with your friends, you're training your cardiovascular system. You can measure this marker of health by performing something called a VO2 max test, or a predicted VO2 max test, which essentially just measures how efficiently your body is exchanging oxygen at the lungs when you exercise. You should always take this measurement at the start of your program to serve as a benchmark for future tests, allowing you to plot your progress over time. The program you build should enable for the steady increase in your VO2 max score, so it eventually lands in the average to above average score of the test chart. The higher your VO2 max score, the more efficient you are at metabolizing fat and carbohydrates as energy, which means the faster you can burn excess fat. The final component of health-related fitness is body composition. Body composition is just the ratio of lean mass like bones, organs, muscles, and fluids in contrast with fat mass. Body composition can be measured many different ways, but the quickest way for you to get an idea of your body composition and the effects that it's having on your health is with a quick waist-to-hip ratio calculation. This test, however, will only be applicable if your waist is smaller than 35 inches for women and 40 inches for men. Don't worry, if you fall outside this waist measurement, we'll go over in further detail some other tests that you can perform in a later video. So start by taking a tailor's tape and measure the circumference at the widest part of your hips. Note the measurement and then take another measurement at the waist just above the bony ridges of your hips, noting that measurement down as well. Now be sure that the tape measure for both of these measurements stays horizontal and not going up or down, it's in a level manner. When you have these two measurements, take the number that you got from your waist and divide it it by the number that you got from your hips. The resulting number is an indicator of your current body composition and its risk that it imposes to your health. This chart indicates the health risks and at-risk zones for both male and female. I've included that chart for you to reference in the video description. Okay, let's now move on to skill-related fitness.